Now let's start with the potential energy calculation in an external field. Now, this is a wide topic. In this, we are going to consider three important sections. The first section is that when we have to find out the potential energy due to single charge and when it is placed in the external field. Similarly, we have to work upon the two-point charges, and in the third case, we have to work upon the electric dipole. Now, let's start with the first case one by one. So we have to calculate the potential energy due to single point charge. Now, let us first understand what do I mean by the statement external field. This topic is different from what we have studied. Here we are not going to consider the electric field created by the point charge. Here we are going to consider the external field influence on the single point charge. Now, if suppose this is a external field, okay, how this external field is created? Your question might be that from where this external field is coming? This external field is coming from the source charge, and this source charge is placed at a very far distance, let's say at infinity. Okay, so the source charge is placed at a very far distance from our study area. So it is kept near at, let's say, infinity. So let me consider that this is a source charge, and this is producing the electric field, the finite value of the electric field, which is strong enough to produce the influence on another charge. So this is your external electric field, and we have to take any other point charge and place it in the electric field. And where this point charge is? This point charge is anywhere, let's say, at infinity. So at point P, we brought a charge small q, and from where this small q charge comes from? This small q charge comes from infinity all the way while, and we nailed it at the point P. Now, what is our motive? Our motive is to find out the potential energy. And what is the potential energy? We know the definition. The potential energy is the work done in moving the charge from infinity to a particular point. So that means in this particular case, we are talking about the definition. That is the work done in moving the charge from infinity to the point P. Here, that point is the point P. So you have to work upon the point charge, that is Q, which is placed in an external field. Now let's start with the derivation. In this derivation, there are two assumptions. Okay, first we have to assume that potential at infinite is equals to zero. We already have studied about it. That is, if the point charge is at infinity, in that particular case, the force is also zero, the potential energy is also zero, the work done is also zero, and the potential is also zero. And why is it zero? Because the R is at infinity. So in that condition, you can see V is inversely proportional to R. Okay. From the formula, we have seen that V is inversely proportional to R. If R is infinite, then V is what? V is zero. Similar is the condition for force also, for work done also, and for every other parameters also. So we can conclude that if R is infinite, in that condition, the potential, the force, the work done is all zero. So this is our first assumption. The second assumption is that the Q charge should be very, very small. Okay. This Q charge in which we have to calculate the potential should be very, very small. Why it is very small? Because we don't want that this Q charge should create any influence on the electric field which is created by the source charge. Okay. In case, okay, imagine in case it produced some effect on this electric field. So in that particular condition, we have to neglect the effect which is created by this particular charge on the electric field created by the source charge. So in order to consider that the electric field created by this charge is neglected, we should consider that it should be very, very small. If this is very small, so the influence created is also very small. Now, moving on to the derivation part, now let's start with the work done. What is the work done? What is the formula for the work done? The work done is given by the Q, that is I'm talking about the charge. That is the charge which is placed at a point P. And it is multiplied by the potential. What is the potential in this condition? The potential is given by the difference of the two value. In this condition, just look at here. At point P, the potential created is Vp. Because there is an electric field. If the electric field exists, so in that condition, the potential also exists. If I talk about the potential at point P, so it becomes Vp. Similarly, if I talk about the potential at infinite, so it becomes infinite. And if we are asking to calculate the work done, so work is always done against the nature of the charge. What is the nature of this Q charge? The nature of the Q charge is to move with the flow of the electric field, that is in the direction of the electric field. If we have to do some work, so we have to work against the direction of the electric field. That is, we have to work against the nature of the charge. And when the force is applied against the nature of the charge, then only the work is done. In this condition, the work is done in moving the charge from infinity to the point P, because the nature of the charge is to move from P to infinity. So we are doing the work against the nature of the charge. So in this condition, the potential is also applied from infinity to the point P. That is, at infinity, the potential is V infinity. At point P, the potential is Vp. So now we can write it as Vp minus V of infinite. And V of infinite, we already assume that is zero. So it becomes zero in this condition. So the work done is now Q into V. Okay, Vp is the potential at point P. So we have said here Q into Vp. Now, what is the potential energy? The potential energy is the same as the work done. And if you have to write down the formula for Vp, so what can be the formula for Vp? The formula for Vp becomes Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught, and the distance between them is R. Okay, it is given to you that point P is at a distance R from the source charge. So in that condition, if we have to find the potential, so the distance is also R. If you substitute this formula into this equation, so potential energy is given as the work done. It is also given as Q small q upon 4 pi epsilon naught R. So this is the formula for the potential energy if we consider for the single point charge. Now, in this condition, there are two important points for you to remember by heart. The first important point is, if I ask you that what is the sign of the potential energy, okay? In this condition, just look at this formula. If I ask you that this potential energy is always positive or is always negative, so your answer should be, it depends upon the polarity of the charges. Okay, so now let's see what do you mean by polarity of the charges. In the first condition, let's say if the source charge is plus Q and the test charge is minus Q, that is, this charge and this charge, both charges are of opposite polarity, plus and minus. So what is the force between them? The force between them is the force of attraction. Now, you can see here that this is positive, this is negative, so the force exists between them is the force of attraction. If we put this value into this formula, so this is plus, this is minus, then whole value, whole formula turns to be negative. So in this condition, the potential energy comes to be negative. Just remember by heart that if the polarity of the two charges are opposite in nature, in that condition, the potential energy is always negative. Similarly, you have to see that if the two charges are of same polarity, that is, source charge is also plus Q and the test charge is also plus Q. In this condition, both are positive. So what is the force between them? The force is force of repulsion. So in that condition, the force exists is repulsive. Now, putting these particular values into this formula, what it becomes? Positive, positive. The answer is also positive. So the potential energy calculated in this condition is also positive. So these are the two important points that you have to remember by heart as you have studied about all the laws, Fleming's right hand and left hand. So this is also an important rule for you that if they are of opposite polarity, then the potential energy is negative. If they are of same polarity, then the potential energy is positive. Now moving on to the second part, that is to find out the potential energy due to the electron. Now, this is the formula for the potential energy. Similarly, this is also the same formula for the potential energy. We have to find out the potential energy due to electron. How electron is notified? The charge of the electron is notified by small e. And what is the polarity of the electron? It possesses the negative polarity. So in this condition, the potential energy becomes, instead of q, we are going to write minus e into v. Minus E represents the electron. Now, what is the charge of one electron? The charge of one electron is 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 coulomb. Okay, this is all what we know, that it is 1.6 into 10 raised to the minus 19 coulomb. At a potential, let's say the potential in this condition is 1 volt. If you put all these value into this equation, you will get the potential energy. What is the magnitude of the potential energy in this condition? The magnitude of the potential energy becomes 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19 joule. The unit turns to joule. Okay, there's another unit for that. Then that unit comes from this particular expression. This expression is electron volt. So, another unit for joule in this condition, that is in the condition of electron, is electron volt. Now, it is represented in joule and it is a very small quantity. If we have to go into the atomic, nuclear or particle physics, then in that condition, the quantity of the energy is also increased. And the quantity of energy is increased by some particular units. The units are, let's say, 1 kilo electron volt. Similarly, the bigger units are 1 million electron volt and the other are 1 giga electron volt. Okay, let's see the conversion. What are the conversion? 1 kilo electron volt is represented as 1 electron volt into 10 raised to the power 3. Similarly, it is represented as 1 electron volt into 10 raised to the power 6. And giga is represented as 1 electron volt into 10 raised to the power 9. 1 electron volt is known to you, that is 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 19. So in this condition, 1 kilo electron volt will give you answer 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 16 joule. Similarly, it gives you the answer 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 13 joule. And likewise, it gives you 1.6 into 10 raised to the power minus 10 joules. Okay, so this is the conversion unit. Instead of joule, you can also write electron volt. Now, these all are the conversion unit. Just learn it by heart. And these are also equally important for your numerical perspective also. Now, moving on to the next topic, that is to find out the potential energy due to the system of two point charges when they are placed in an external field. Now, here we are talking about two point charges. We have just seen the case of the single point charge. Moving on to the two point charges, the case is somewhat different, but not too much. Okay, the concept remains the same. Now, let's first find out. First, in this condition, you have to draw the external field. Again, the external field comes because all this study, all these three parts, I've already told you that there are three parts and all these three parts deals with the external field. So this is the external field and this external field is created by what? By the source charge. This source charge is placed at infinity. It produces a finite and strong electric field which is directed in this particular direction. Now, let us start with one by one charges. The first charge, let's say, is placed at a point P. This is a point P. At this point, we have to place one charge. Okay, first charge. That charge, let's say, is Q1. This Q1 charge comes all the way while from the infinity and reach at point P. Similarly, this is placed at a distance, let's say R1. Likewise, there is another point, let's say Q. At Q, there is second charge, let's say Q2. Q2 also travels all the way from the infinity and reach to the point Q in an external field. And this is placed at a distance, let's say R2. So this is all what we need. Okay, Q1 and Q2 are small enough so that they do not interfere with the electric field created by the source charge. So first let's find out the work done by the charge Q1. Okay, when we brought the charge Q1 from infinity to the point P, then we have done some work. And what is this work? This work is done against the external field. Which external field? The external field which is created by this source charge. If there is an external field, so there must be the existence of the potential also. So what is the formula for the work done? In this condition, the work done is given by the potential at point P multiplied by the concerned charge. What is the concerned charge? It is Q1. We are talking about the point P, so at this condition the potential is also at point P. How this potential is created? This potential is created by the electric field. And who generates the electric field? The electric field is generated by the source charge. So when we are going to formulate the potential, so it becomes capital Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught. What is the distance in this condition? The distance between source charge and the point P is given to you, that is R1. So it becomes R1 and this is Q1. So this is the work done which is created at point P. Similarly, we have to find out the work done by Q2 charge. Now you can see here, when we brought Q2 from infinity to the point Q, so in this condition, we have to work against the external field which is created by the source charge. And we also have to work against the electrostatic force which is created by Q1 also. Now, there are two forces that act upon the charge Q2 when the charge Q2 is brought into the electric field. First is the force which is created by the source charge. The second is the force which is created by the Q1. So we have to work in extra in order to overpower these two external forces. So now let's see what is the work we have done in moving the charge Q2 and putting into the position, that is Q. Now in this condition, let us see first the work done against the external field. Against the external field I am talking about. So I am talking about the potential which is created at point Q multiplied by the charge itself, which is Q2. And this potential is created again by the source charge, that is capital Q. So what is the formula? It becomes Q upon 4 pi epsilon naught. Now take a pause. In this condition, the distance is now R2, okay? In the previous case, the distance is R1, but now the distance has modified to R2. So it becomes R2, Q2. So this is the first work done, which we have done against the external field created by the source charge. In the second condition, we have to work against the electrostatic force, which is created by the charge Q1. So what we are going to do, that we have to work against the Q1 force. Okay, in that condition, the potential again is created at point Q multiplied by Q2. In this condition, at point Q, the potential is created by the charge Q1. Okay, so now the charge becomes Q1 instead of capital Q. The external field is created by capital Q, so in the formula it becomes capital Q. In this condition, the repulsive force is created by Q1, so in the formula it becomes Q1. Don't get confused with that. You only have to find out that which energy or which source is producing the potential. Okay, in all these values, the potential is created by the external field, but in this particular condition, the potential is created by the charge Q1. So now 4 pi epsilon naught, which is a constant. Similarly, distance between the two charges. Now, this is Q1 and this is Q2. If we have to find the distance between them, let's say we take R12. Now, here we have to write R12 because we are considering the two charges Q1 and Q2. So, the distance between them is also R12. So, this is the work done in order to overpower the electrostatic repulsive force created by Q1. If you have to find the total work done at point Q. So, what is the total work done in this condition? You have to add these two equations. That is 1 plus 2. So, just add these two equations. You will get the total work done at point Q. At point P, the work done is given by this formula. Let us represent it by capital A. Similarly, at point Q, the formula modifies to this. Let us represent it by capital P. If you have to find out the total work done of the whole system of two point charges, so what you are going to do? You have to add A and B equation. You will get the total work done. So this is the total work done. Now I'm going to modify this total work done somewhat like this, that it is WT. Okay. Now in these two particular terms, you can see capital Q is common. Okay. So I'm going to take capital Q out of these two particular terms, and inside the bracket, what we are left with, you can see here, this is the potential which is created at point R1. This is the potential which is created at point R2. So we can write it as V at point R1. Similarly, we can also write it as V at point R2. If you are going to expand this formula, you will get the same result. And this is a constant, that is Q1, Q2 upon 4 pi epsilon naught R of 1, 2. So now the formula reduced to this particular equation. Now, I have already told you that the work done is equals to the potential energy. So in this condition, this whole equation or this equation, these two represent the same thing. And these two gives you the final answer, that is the potential energy. So this is the potential energy that we have calculated for the system of two point charges.